And let me go back to that letter by Esperon. In his original letter to the NTC, there was no direct allegation against Bulatlat. But yesterday, in his press release, he accused Bulatlat and Pinoy Weekly of allegedly supporting organizations affiliated with the CPP-NPA-NDF. From your end, is there basis for this claim?
We challenge Esperon to provide his basis. It is not up to us to provide evidence because the action came from him. And it is really unacceptable that these ISPs immediately implemented the order without questioning first the legality and the moral authority of the NTC to implement such blatant, illegal, brazen, and unconstitutional order.
Jonathan, the Esperon press release yesterday quoted two articles from Pinoy Weekly. And let me quote the titles. The first one, Limang Katwiran ng Armadong Pakikibaka. And the second one, NPA at Masa Di Matitinig. And these are supposedly proof of support for organizations affiliated with the CPP-NPA-NDF. From your point of view, are these enough? Publishing these articles, are these enough for one to be branded as affiliated with the CPP-NPA-NDF? And what's the danger when the government actually looks into the language of the articles, the content of the publication, to accuse the media of committing acts related to terrorism?
And yun nga, no, it does show na during the when the Anti-Terrorism Act was at the Supreme Court, no, that was one of the fears raised that, for example, nga, interviewing rebels or providing the perspective from their side would be seen as support, no, and hindi naman siya ganun. We're journalists have to look at all points of view, no, and giving that point of view space or airtime doesn't mean support for it, doesn't mean we're encouraging people to join and, or it's not support or affiliation, it's part of the job. You have to get their side as well, and so in your fear now, if you get their perspective, or actually even just the perspective of groups that the government says is affiliated with the communist rebels, no, parang you'll be targeted too. And ito nga yung nakikita natin in this case, I think.
And to be clear, there is nothing in the Anti-Terrorism Act nor its IRR consequence of being designated as a terrorist. And yet, the National Security Council were able to do this. So what's your take on this? You questioned this very Anti-Terrorism Act before the Supreme Court. Unfortunately, the Supreme Court upheld most of the provision. We have this situation where, as you pointed out in your statement yesterday, the thing that you feared is actually happening.
Yun nga siya, no? So they did reassure us that it won't happen. Pero yun na nga siya, and Esperon is citing specific provisions,
yes,
from the law. Pero that's not in the that's not in the NTC memo. That's not in his letter. Mm-hmm. No, but if that's the case, then there should be siguro, like, they should go through a court or something to before this happens. Hindi pwedeng they just give an allegation and then hours later they'll say, actually, this is what we mean by this, no? So napaka-arbitrary nga niya, and this really does show that if they want to, then they'll do it, and bahala na yung explanation later. They say that the groups have a legal they can pursue legal remedies, no? But they didn't say, or it's not clear what those legal remedies are or if they can even appeal this blocking, no?
Jonathan, looking at those articles, the title of those articles, just by mere publishing, is that reason for you to be prosecuted under the Anti-Terrorism Act? Because they're citing two provisions. One is supposedly Section 9, which is inciting to terrorism. Although in the letter it says definition of terrorism, which is in a different section. And the other one is Section 10 on recruitment. Do you think that by publishing these articles, you're already recruiting members? You're already inciting people to commit acts of terrorism?
No. It's a point of view. It's a perspective that was published, no, and parang ano yan, papasok ka sa editorial judgment, which is, well, it's up to the newsroom. No? And if it is dangerous to publish that, then I feel that determination should be done not by a council, but siguro by a court or mm-hmm. ganyan, no? I mean, it's not even for me to say na it's wrong or what. Kasi editorial judgment yun of the newsrooms.
Do you feel there is prior restraint here? Because before you get to publish, your websites have already been blocked. If they're going after a particular publication that had been previously published, why don't they file a particular case in court under the Anti-Terrorism Act if they're citing certain provisions? So do you think there's a case of prior restraint here?
Oh, yes, definitely. And and parang they're going into content and that's not for them to determine, I feel, no? So yeah.
Len, it wasn't so long ago that Bulatlat was also the subject of DDoS or distributed denial of service attacks. Do you think there's any connection? Is there any indication that those attacks are in any way related to the blocking of your website now?
Definitely, we think there's a connection because Bulatlat has been red tagged repeatedly. Mm-hmm. And the last cyber attack incident in 2021 was traced to the Philippine Army.
Mm.
And now there's a black and white memo from the NTC. So definitely all these attacks are state-sponsored. And this brings across the message that anyone who practices independent journalism would be targeted. And that's very chilling. So we call on our colleagues, we thank our colleagues for standing up for press freedom because this is not only an issue for Bulatlat, like what they did to ABS-CBN, di ba? It's also a form of censorship. So ito, iba lang forma. But they could also, again, do that to other media outlets.
So you're saying this is like an online form of the shutdown of the broadcast operations of ABS-CBN in a way?
Yes, exactly.
And what are your next steps moving forward, Len? Because Esperon was saying yesterday that anyway, the blocking of the websites only applies to the Philippines. You can still be accessed outside the Philippines. So he's saying there's no denial of press freedom. But what are your next steps?
Alam mo, nakakatawa talaga yun na nakakagalit eh, di ba? Parang he is contradicting himself. But we already talked with our lawyers and we're weighing our options. First, of course, is to stop sana this implementation of the order. And second, to question the legality. So kung aabot tayo sa Anti-Terror Act, na malamang ay umabot tayo doon, ang silver lining lang is that here comes an opportunity for us again to question this unconstitutional law. As cited in the NUJP and Concerned Artists of the Philippines joint petition, yung inciting to terrorism talaga yung ginamit na ano eh, na provision ni Esperon. So we would like to question that again.
And Jonathan, do you see this as an opportunity the NSC and the NTC giving some of critics of the anti-terrorism law, in fact, the ammunition to directly assail the law as applied to certain individuals here, journalists and news organizations, and try to challenge it again before the Supreme Court?
Yeah, yeah. Yes, because we're seeing that, well, you know, they did reassure us that this won't happen, but it has happened. So, and, you know, we're seeing how they're applying the law. So it's, yeah, again, it's a new opportunity to question it. And, pero nga, medyo malayo pa yung, in the meantime, I think we should keep this issue alive. We should keep making noise about it, no? But yes, definitely, it's something to go back to.
Mm-hmm. And lastly, Jonathan, the move to block access to Bulatlat and Pinoy Weekly and other website, this comes at tail end of the Duterte administration on the eve of a Bongbong Marcos presidency. What should the media expect under the new administration? What can we do about it?
Ayun, we feel that it will be a continuation of the Duterte administration's policies. No, in nga, especially nga, if we let this pass, then this could just parang the Marcos administration will inherit this, and parang may precedent na for it. No, And yun nga, we're fearing that there will be more attempts to silence the press, more attempts to sideline the press. And this could be one of the first steps for that. No, pwedeng, yun nga, as we saw in the transition towards the Duterte administration, parang parang yung sa drug war, no? So this could be part of that, na parang to show na ganito yung magiging forma in the next few years. No?
Mm-hmm. And very quickly, final word to you, Len. Why should this issue be a concern of the bigger population, not just journalists, not just those websites covered by the NTC order?
Ang talo dito kasi yung publiko, yung ating audience. So any form of censorship is a disservice to the public because what we do is for public good, diba? So journalism is not a crime and we should be allowed to carry on our work as journalists. So right. We call on the public to continue supporting us.
Mm-hmm. On that note, thank you so much for joining us this morning, Ms. Len Ulea, Managing Editor of Bulatlat, and Jonathan De Santos, the Chair of the National Union of Journalists of the Philippines.
Thank you.
Thank you.